naming God and the techné of language, and I did have a subtitle, Can We Name God Wrongly, which we'll come to. So, as we've heard already, techné is anciently a craft, a skill, a knowing of the body and the hands as well as of the mind, and human language is thus a superb, possibly the supreme techné, involving, of course, as it does, our bodies and our lungs and our lips, as well as our brains, yet for all that seeming to us so effortlessly acquired. Yet language is not quite like breathing, eating, or sleeping. It's a natural predisposition, but language is culturally configured. We may, most of us, quite naturally acquire our native speech, but we acquire Urdu or Mandarin or Czech, all languages which are, as much as automobiles and systems of government, artifacts and constructs, languages are socially transmitted. The history of language and its transmission is, as we've heard this morning already, a history of advancing technologies. Speech and the desire to communicate gives rise to script and vehicles for script. The earliest inscriptions on rock and clay are often records of debt or trade relations, but quickly we see a flowering into texts of poetry, song, and religion. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are especially identified as religions of the book, or we might more reasonably say, religions of the text, first on clay, stone, and papyri, and vellum scrolls, but then on paper and printed books. The reception of ancient texts, in turn, is affected by the technology of transmission. The codex, which we think to have been introduced at the time of the emergence of Christianity, transformed the reading of the scriptures, whose former vehicle was the scroll. In fact, it's believed that the codex, which is still the basic book form we use today, may have originated in popularity with the Christian apologists who needed an easy and quick way to flip back through a text to find a proof. For example, a passage of Isaiah which they judged to presage a story in the life of Jesus. Printing then transformed the reception of Christian scriptures, not least by making it popular for even the relatively poor to possess a copy of the complete Bible in their own vernacular. Yet, religious language isn't subsumed by texts and their transmission, but involves traditions of reading, of symbolism, and oral practice. A child's usually effortless acquisition of language is striking in its early stages, both for an inadvertent neologism, invention of words. So, for instance, one of mine, when very young, having been stung by a wasp, and soon after, for the first time, seeing fireworks, called them wasp bangs, which that's an example of typical neologisms children come up with. But quickly, children become adept language users and intentionally use metaphors, similes, puns, skills that computers have yet to match. Children quickly understand and deploy indexicals. They know that my mum, uttered by one child, has a different referent than my mum, uttered by their friend. And they know that tomorrow means a different day each day it is uttered. As Wittgenstein and Augustine variously observed, we are inducted into a world. This is not rank relativism, or translation would be impossible. And even within a given natural language, whether French or Hindi or Czech, there are specialist languages into which the apprentice must be inducted. The language of the brewer, or the biochemist, the composer, the wheel maker, or the painter. And to our purposes, the languages of a faith tradition. This induction involves more than being able to read a text. Bishop Ambrose, in the first days after St. Augustine's conversion, told Augustine to read the book of Isaiah, but Augustine couldn't make anything out of it and wisely decided to put it away until, as Augustine said, he had more practice in the Lord's style of language. In short, he had to learn to read aspects of the Hebrew Bible as typologically pointing forward to the coming Christ. When we come to naming God, we're again entering into a developed set of socially transmitted practices based on prayer liturgy and meditation. And it's of interest to us in a project to do with foundational reflections on theology and technology might be to help us to think about the complexities of religious understandings to questions of continuity and change. So why name God? And why any complexity with the naming of God? Is God God's name? And what are names for anyway? We usually think of names as designations, and in the first sense we think of proper names, which means technically names like Helen Alford, Simon Walker, Julia Smith. But in this sense, God is not God's name. God is not the proper name of God. God is not a proper name, but a kind term, like cow or chicken. Elijah could talk about the gods of the prophets of Baal. He could pluralize it. We can make God a plural. We can translate it into many different languages, which characteristically we don't do with Helen Alford. We don't translate that into a different language when we're speaking Czech. Names include thus more than proper names. They have their place in forms of life. We use names to call to people, to call upon people, to indicate relationship. We may name the judge in a court as Your Honor, or an office bearer as Madam President. These names are context specific. You wouldn't call someone Your Honor outside of the court of law. Certain names can be used only by certain individuals. Any one of you may call me Janet Soskice, but only two people in the world call me Mum. In Christianity, as in many religions, God is invoked by many names. In previous times, these were often formalized in liturgies and prayers. So in the pre-modern marriage ceremony in England, the Sarum Rite, the heavenly choir was invoked to proclaim the names of the Most High God. And there was a long, long list of which only a few I give you. Messiah, Emmanuel, Firstborn, Alpha, Omega, Lamb, Serpent, Goat, Lion, Worm, Splendor, Bridegroom, many, many more. Earlier generations of theologians, not only Pseudo-Dionysius in his famous essay on the divine names, but Aquinas, Ambrose, Albert the Great, all wrote treatises and meditations on the divine names. And in fact, this is one of the things that fascinated me in the topic originally, in the past, theologians seemed far more interested in how it is we could name God than as today how it might be we could prove that God exists. What pre-modern theologians discussed as divine names in modernity increasingly became reduced in both Catholic and Protestant circles to the so-called classical attributes or divine attributes, and this list became increasingly few: immutable, eternal, one, being, and so on. In the medieval discussions, these were surrounded by a vast penumbra of other names, such as those I've mentioned. The wider horizons of the venerable lists of their names and their place in liturgy, prayer, and supplication were largely forgotten. Now, in recent times, there's been a return to the question, must we call God Father? Can we baptize only in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? And most recently, Pope Francis published a book entitled The Name of God is Mercy. This was a campaigning book aimed, I think, largely at priests, arguing that the church must be a field hospital in which treatment is given to the most wounded. And in this, the church must show a motherly face, show love. And citing Pope Benedict, Francis said that mercy is in reality the core of the gospel message. It is the name of God, God's self, revealed in the Old Testament and fully in Christ. Mercy is the first attribute of God. And even more emphatically, Francis said, mercy is the name of God. Now, Pope Francis here is especially indebted to a book by Cardinal Walter Kasper entitled Mercy, the Essence of the Gospel and the Key to Christian Life. That's a very good book, and Cardinal Kasper thinks divine mercy has been criminally neglected and points to all the time given in handbook theology, as he describes it, theology of the 19th century Catholic Church, all the attention given to the divine attributes derived, as he said, from God's metaphysical essence as subsistent being itself, ipsum esse subsistens. This is the focus he said, Casper says, of the handbooks. So we talk about God's simplicity, infinity, eternity, omnipotence, and so on. Here, Casper continues, we should merely point out, within the parameters of metaphysical attributes of God, there's scarcely room for the concept of mercy, which derives not from the metaphysical essence, but rather from the historical self-revelation of God. Cardinal Casper then takes us back to the primordial text for the names and the naming of God in the Christian and Jewish tradition, which is exactly Moses at the burning bush, the book of Exodus. And here you have, this is one from the wonderful apse mosaic at St. Catherine's in Mount Sinai, the young Moses taking off his shoes before the burning bush. Implicit in his criticism is that later theology, handbook theology, in that metaphysical characterizations have supplanted what in the biblical text were a series of names denoting mercy, intimacy, and trust. So let's go back to the encounter of Moses at Sinai by way of inducting ourselves into the Christian techné of naming God. And here you see the Sinai Peninsula. St. Catherine's, as you know, is just on the bottom at the right. So summoned to the burning bush, Moses is addressed by God. I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt, says God. And Moses is requested to return to Egypt, where he knows he's unwelcome, and to tell the Pharaoh to let my people go. Moses, uncertain about the wisdom of God's actions, begins to negotiate with God, and in the course of this, very perplexingly, asks God for a name. If, he says, they ask me, they, the Israelites, what is his name? What shall I say to them? Now, why does Moses ask for a name? What kind of proof could this be for the Israelites? Do we see here the residue of an Egyptian cultic religion with a special claim on owning the name of the deity, meaning one has a special hold on it? Walter Moberly and many others think not. He points out that throughout this section of Exodus, the known unknown is to the fore. At the burning bush, Moses knows, yet does not know, who it is that addresses him. The narrative emphasizes holiness. Moses is told to take off his sandals, for a place he stands is holy ground. And there you see, again, him taking off his sandals. So this is one of the astonishing features of the narrative, the holiness and the intimacy, the closeness of those two together. At this moment of heightened holiness, Moses makes bold to address God and ask for a name. And even more startling in terms of the narrative, God gives one. God says, I am who I am. This, he says, is what you must say to the sons of Israel. I am has sent me to you. And God said also to Moses, you are to say to the sons of Israel, Yahweh, the Lord, your father, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. So this is Moses receiving the law at the also on Sinai, and a shot of the convent at St. Catherine's, and as it appears today. So what is his name? What shall I say to them? Now, as we go on with this, you see that there's more than one name given in the reply of Yahweh, or the Lord, I shall say, to Moses. But the one that caught the attention of Christian theologians from very early on was I am who I am, which both in the Greek, emo eimi ho on, and in the Latin, ego sum qui sum, seemed to the fathers to have powerful metaphysical resonance. However, the name central to someone reading the text in Hebrew is not this, but rather the four-lettered name of God, the Tetragrammaton. Unfortunately, the Tetragrammaton, the four-lettered name of God, is often elided, certainly in English language translations of the Bible. I don't know what you find in Czech or Hungarian or your own languages, which simply puts in the word Lord in capital letters. But wherever we see this in the translation of the Hebrew Bible, wherever we see Lord, capital L-O-R-D, it is actually the Tetragrammaton in the original. Now, this is a very ancient name for God, the Tetragrammaton, and it is the only candidate for a proper name of God in the Hebrew Bible. Like other proper names, Fred and Alice and Helen, it doesn't strictly have a meaning, but it gives the appearance of a form of the Hebrew verb to be. And hence, the gloss or the pun that God appears to make to Moses to say, I am who I am. So that tetragrammaton technically has no meaning, but it appears to be like the Hebrew verb to be, and God in this text glosses it this way. Now, the Hebrew of the text probably shouldn't be translated as I am who I am. Probably better, there are many suggestions, but it's a present and a future. I am the one who is with you and will be with you, something like that. And translated in this way, it's far from being frightening and frightful. It is clearly a name of promise, and just such a name you might think that Moses might need if he's going to lead a large group of women, men, and livestock from the relative prosperity of the Nile to the desolate desert. And this seems to put in a very bad light the historical Christian privileging of I am who I am, or he who is, as the name given to Moses. Have the Christian theologians made from a moment of intimacy and promise for assistance a monster of philosophical abstraction? So thought Buber and Rosenzweig. Is revelation supplanted by metaphysics? I think yes, and I think no. And to see why this is so, and I think why we may answer no as well, we need to look to the emergent, some of the history of reception of this text of Exodus, and particularly its glossing in the neglected figure of Philo of Alexandria. Now, Philo was a Greek-speaking Jew of the first century, and thus contemporary of St. Paul, about whom he knows nothing, but like Paul, was educated in Greek grammar, rhetoric, and philosophy, and had, as far as we can see, no Hebrew. He seemed to read his own scriptures, his own Jewish scriptures, entirely in the Greek of the Septuagint. Philo is trained in the fusion at that time of Platonic, Aristotelian, Stoic philosophy that became the common philosophical style of his time. But he's different. He's able to differentiate what he wants to say often from what he finds, for instance, in the text of Aristotle. And he's very, very interested in naming and in naming God. Now, this was a slight interest in other middle Platonic philosophers or in Plato himself. But it's a very great interest from Philo, and this, I shall argue, is an urgent matter for him because he's Jewish, and it's also, as it will emerge, an impossibility because of his own Jewish faith. Now, when he writes on the difficulties of naming and knowing God, which he does frequently throughout his diverse writings, he writes as one aware of the difficulties of applying accepted precepts of Greek philosophical literature to naming the God of Israel. In particular, to name something in the Greek grammar and philosophy of his time, you had to be able to delineate its essence. And Philo doesn't think you can delineate the divine essence. Not only, it's strictly impossible, it would be heretical if you could, but you can't do it. And in particular, he's aware of the implications of the Jewish teachings of God as creator. Now, strictly speaking, neither Plato nor Aristotle have a creator God. Plato has a demiurge who molds a pre-existing matter, and Aristotle's God is more like the DNA of the universe, oblivious to its course of action in any particulars. But not so the Hebrew scriptures. They suggest a God who creates under no compulsion, entirely freely. The creation, the theology of creation which nourished Philo and the Jews of the period, including the Jews who wrote the Christian New Testament, comes not just from the book of Genesis, but from Isaiah, the Psalms, where persistently God's role of creator of all that is invoked in describing his loving acts on behalf of Israel and his sovereignty over winds, waves, and roaring mountains. Only God creates, and God creates and sustains and holds in being all that is. Philo believes that God has created the world out of non-being, and Philo believes that God has created time in itself. Precisely because he's working in the Greek milieu, he has to distinguish his Jewish philosophy from this, and he rejects outright Aristotle's idea that the universe is eternal, that is everlasting, an idea he thinks incompatible with providence. Now, these ideas are altogether critical for his reflections on the naming of God. Since God is the creator of time and space, God's self, God is not like any created thing. God is no thing, in Martin's words this morning. So God cannot be like any created being, and we cannot class God or insert God into any category appropriate to created kind. On the other hand, because he's Jewish, Philo believes God must not be left wholly in the realms of abstraction. Above all, we must be able to pray to God. Indeed, in Hebrew, to pray is to call upon the name of the Lord. And it's here that the burning bush becomes important. We cannot, of our own, Philo believes, name God, but God, in God's grace, has given us names by which we may call upon him. Philo believes that God has given names, and that's what he thinks is happening in the sequence where God asks for a name. So reminds, that's what Philo thinks is asked when is happening when God is asked for a name and gives these glosses on the name. That Philo believes God is giving us names by which we can name God. So if his Jewish scriptures push Philo towards the assertion that, you see, here's the quote, I won't read it for you now. Philo believes that God can't be named in God's self, but we can name God by various traces God leaves and by names that God gives to us. And Philo repeatedly links the disclosure of the name to Moses, the I Am, back to the creation narrative of Genesis, the idea being that God, the God who truly is, and all creature reality comes from God and has its being in God. And this is not, I think, this idea that God is the source of all that is and that all comes from him, and linking this back to the I Am, is not just an idiosyncrasy of the fact he works in the Greek language, so not just, as it were, corruption by Greek metaphysics. We find the same connection between the I Am that is given to Moses, this I Am, and various glosses in the Targums, the Aramaic Targums, if you could move on. Yeah, so there you have the glosses that are in the Aramaic Targums. These, as I've said, are not Greek, but Aramaic, the Semitic language, and these are all glosses on Exodus 3:15. So you get Pseudo-Jonathan, he who spoke when the world came into being, spoke and everything came into being. He who said to the world, be, and it came into being, and who will again say, be, and it will be. So you get this connection already through from this Moses utterance to Moses and the creation narrative of Genesis. Now, Philo, it's interesting to note, believes that God is unnameable, but that God has given these names to be by which we can name him. We cannot name what God is in God's self, but we can name who God is for us. And so he sees as preeminent the name, I am the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. This doesn't indicate what God is in God's self. It doesn't delineate the divine essence, but it says who this God is for us. God is shown through his mighty acts. And we see God's traces also in creation. These creatures do not share the divine reality, but have their reality through the divine will. The holy name, the tetragrammaton, glosses then as I am who I am. But it is not a bold metaphysical claim, but I think anchored for these ancient writers in the Jewish and Christian doctrine of creation. It is a name, according to piety, that God gave God's self. It is not, as handled by classical theologians, an answer at all to what God is in terms of omniscience, omnipotence, and so on, but rather points to who God is, the God of Israel, the one who made heaven and earth. The anchorage is not the book of Genesis, or not solely that, but the Psalms and the prophets. And I think of the next slide. So these are the kinds of Psalms that are cited again and again by writers writing about the name of God and creation. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. So you see it right at the end there. This is the God who creates all that is and holds all that is in being. First, now let me make three points. First, and these hold, I think, from Christianity right in the earliest days to right the late medieval period and into modernity. First, divine creation is not something that happened long ago, but what is happening now. Julian of Norwich captures this when, in her vision, she sees the world as a tiny hazelnut in the palm of her hand, notes its extreme fragility, but says it exists because God loves it. Not it exists in the first place, it only exists now because God loves it. Second, this is not a distant God. In the contrary, unlike the gods of classical philosophical monotheism, this is a God who knows all things in particular. This is not an onto-theological God in the Heideggerian sense, because this is not an element of the ontological continuum in any sense at all. It is no thing. Third, and there's a very distinctive emphasis in the Jewish and Christian text on speaking and naming. And we've already talked about this in summoning and naming. In the Hebrew Bible, God speaks the world into being and names his creations. I've tried to give you, in this reflection, a small digest of what is a long sequence of reflections on Exodus 3, the burning bush, and why the name I Am, who I am, has been privileged by Christians. It is not, as I've said, an account of the divine essence, but names a relation. God is the ever-present source of our being and of all that is. Yet we can see the danger of this name given to Moses, or rather the gloss on the name, the tetragrammaton, if we stop too soon in our reading of the book of Exodus. Walter Moberly notes that there are only 4 points in the Hebrew Bible where God is represented in commenting on the holy name. All four are in the book of Exodus. And they involve an unfolding, and it was in pre-critical times judged to be a divine unfolding of the divine nature. And keynote here is Exodus 33:17. And I think we may have that. So you see this here, this is in Exodus 33:17, I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. I will show mercy to those who show mercy. The Lord, a God merciful, rakum, and gracious, hinun, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Now this brings us back to what Cardinal Casper said, the superlative attribute of mercy. And we see this is not a result of speculative statement or of mystical experience, but rather is a statement of faith on the basis of God's historical self-revelation. In my terms, this God is not a what, but a who. This is the God who has seen the sufferings of the Israelites. This is the God who spoke to Moses at the burning bush. This is the God who, when Moses asked for a name, gave Moses a name or names. Casper's version of Exodus 3:14 is not I am who I am, but God is being for his people, which is also a lovely translation. Yet at the same time, this is the eternal God who is unchanging in forgiveness, mercy, and loving kindness. This is at the heart of our thinking about Jesus, who, as Bonhoeffer reminded us, must start from the question who, not what. The one who saves, the one who is the ground of our being, the one who is God with us, Emmanuel, and the one who is the Alpha and the Omega, as we reflected this morning, the first and the last in the book of Revelation. Now, it won't have escaped you that in the New Testament, all these divine titles that we have already in the Hebrew Bible become applied to Jesus. Alpha and Omega, Emmanuel, Rod of Jesse, Key of David. We see them in the O antiphons that are said in the Advent liturgies we'll soon be experiencing in the Catholic Church. All these titles and names for God are anchored in the Hebrew Bible, anchored in Revelation and salvation history, with Adonai, the Greek substitute for Lord, which in turn is a substitute for the unalterable holy name, prominent among them. Yet all also become names for Jesus, and particularly, it's similarly with a biblical precedent in St. Paul that we find an early piece of Christian writing in Philippians. It's so-called Christ hymn extolling Jesus as the name of God. And I think we should have another slide. Nope, another one? Nope, we have to go back. I think that I was bringing you again to the burning bush here. But you'll remember this passage in Philippians 2:9-11. It's the so-called Christ hymn of Philippians. Therefore God has highly exalted him, who gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven on earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, the glory of God the Father. Now, the scriptural allusion in this hymn, which is very ancient and may be already known to Paul's audience, is to Isaiah 45, the call to the nations, where the Lord, the tetragrammaton, declares, to me every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. Here, Paul shockingly identifies Jesus with this holy name. The names of God are names, not of what God is in God's self, but confessions of who God is for us. And here I think, yes, we're on the right slide, philosophy and revelation are not in competition, but complement one another. God can't be contained or constrained by our naming, but can be called upon and praised. In the end, all our names are not a name of a what, but a who. Who God is for us. This is theology as a kind of practice. Why then name God at all? This brings us to the craft or techné of naming within the received practices of Christianity. We name to praise, to recall God's mighty works, God's infinite mercies, to call upon the name of the Lord in supplication, to recount God's goodness, all elements of the practice of faith. In all of this, God is in one sense utterly unnameable, and in another sense named by many names, names which tie those who worship today in their scriptures, into their scriptures, and into a history and interpretation and reception of these scriptures that goes across the ages. The names carry associations from the Bible and the history of salvation, from the words of Moses and the prophets, the time of exile and liberation. Repeating them, praying them, praising by means of them is an induction into the shared life of Christian faith, a techné, if you prefer, frequently at the level of home or parish liturgy. There's no absolute reason to privilege one name or set of names over the others, which, with the exception possibly, I believe, of the tetragrammaton and its gloss, Ea Esher Ea. The translation, I am who I am, has its limitations, but at least to its credit, retains the first person mode of address. It is a first person address of God. Imagine the God of Aristotle doing such a thing. It is the Lord who speaks intimately to Moses. Aristotle's God would not have done that.